It's coding time again, and today we are going to talk about concurrent.future module in Python. Before I go ahead, let me tell you that something similar to futures are not unique to Python. It is there in pretty much every programming language in some way or other. And the irony is that this was created to make programmers' life easier in terms of writing multi-threaded or multi-process code. But unfortunately, most of the time, I have seen that programmers are struggling with it. And the reason might be that they are trying to, you know, just remember the syntax rather than understanding the same. It is also true that if you are a very good multi-threaded programmer, you may not need it because this is created to make programmers' life easy. You may not need that kind of ease because you are an expert. So before going ahead and showing you the code, let me tell you something about this future, which will help you to learn futures not only in Python, but also in any other programming language. Consider futures just as a ticketing system. You raise a ticket for something, and the only thing that can be done is that this ticket will be acting asynchronously, just like a ticketing system in your real life. You raise a ticket, you go on with your day-to-day life, and ticket is resolved after some time. And there are two ways to get the results of the ticket. Either, you know, I raise the ticket and come back to ticket at some later point of time, and at that point of time, either the ticket is finished or not finished, and we can wait for it. Or we can raise the ticket and keep on waiting for it till it gets finished. But there is one thing is that you will get a notification once the ticket is finished. And for that, you need to call a function. You can call the function and wait, or you can call the function at some later point of time. So this is all about what futures does. It says that, you know, just give me the complexity of raising tickets or creating something in a threaded environment, I'll take care of the rest. So this concept is same for pretty much every programming language. Now let's come back to Python. Let's see the code, and we are gonna see how we can make use of concurrent.future modules. And in this particular video, I am talking about only thread pool executor, which means I am only talking about how to create multiple threads. Creating multiple processes is similar, but I'm going to talk about that in next video. So let's go ahead and see the Jupyter notebook. So Python concurrent module is all about launching tasks in parallel, okay, without worrying about threading mechanism. From Python documentation, we can see that it is written that concurrent.future module provides a high-level interface for asynchronously executing callables. We all know what are callables, right? Anything which can be called, and calling it asynchronously means in a different thread, okay? Now, one very important distinction, only in Python you should create threads if you have IO bound tasks, and you should create processes if you have CPU bound tasks. This happens because of Python global interpreter lock. This is not true for, I mean, pretty much every other programming languages. Any programming language which can utilize multiple cores, this statement is not true. So don't use this statement in any other programming language, you know, thought process, creation, or even interviews, okay? So before going ahead and, you know, starting with the concurrent future, let's see how we can utilize that. So first and foremost, I'm gonna import time, and I'm gonna create a function which takes time. So I have a function which prints, you know, before and after the sleep, which takes some time. This is my function. And if I call that function, what will happen? I will get the first print, then it will sleep, and then the last print will come into picture. Now, what is the problem we are trying to solve? In the program, we are saying that, look, when some function is sleeping, that means it's an IO bound thing. Everything else is free. Let's do something else while the function is sleeping, right? And that's the reason we create thread, and we can create thread also. Let's first see how to do it with thread. So from the threading, I'll import thread. And if you are not aware of threads, please see my playlist on multi-threading and multi-processing in Python. I'm creating a thread with a target of the same function, which takes time. and I am starting the thread, and while the thread is executing, I am doing something else in the main thread. So you can see that doing something else also got printed while the thread function was being executed. Okay. And just a recap that if I want to wait for the thread to complete, I will have to call a join function. Now you can get the same behavior without using threads. Internally it will use, but you will not call threads. Here is how you can do it. The alternative is concurrent.future. Now, people generally say many things about, you know, whether it is good or bad. I will not say that. I'll just say that whether it is a better alternative or not, it's an individual's perspective. But as a programmer, you must know about it. Only then you can decide whether it is better alternative or not, right? So I'm importing concurrent.future, and from the concurrent.future, I'm importing ThreadPoolExecutor. I need to create multiple threads, and ThreadPoolExecutor is the, you know, class which will help us to do that. Okay. And here is how you use ThreadPoolExecutor. With ThreadPoolExecutor max workers equal to 1, I will talk about what is the meaning of max workers. And I'll say submit the function which takes time. And in the main thread, I am sleeping. Let me not sleep first. And in the main thread, I am sprinting after sleep, calling the result. Okay, just forget after sleep. Let me remove after sleep, calling the result. And then result I will call. Now here is how it works. When I do submit, it will start a thread, okay, based on number of workers which I have defined as a parameter over here, and I can do anything in my main thread. So you can see that while this function takes time to execute, I can print this. Now as the name suggests, result returns the output of what? The thread function. Or once the thread function execution is completed. So let me call this. Okay, you can see that a sleep function called, calling the result, and result was actually waiting till the time thread was completed. The worker thread where I have created my thread function was completed. So if I do time.sleep, nothing will impact. The only thing is that I am sleeping in main thread also, I am sleeping in my thread function also. Now whether the thread is completed or not, if you want to know that, there is a function called done. Let's see how we are gonna call that. So in this particular case, I am submitting and I am checking whether the thread function is done or not. I should get false because I have just started. After sleeping, I am checking the done function, and at that point of time, we will get it true, right? In here, before, false, after sleeping, result is done, okay? Now let's make this, you know, sleep function bit dynamic where we are taking parameters, right? So we are taking a parameter that how many seconds I have to sleep. Don't worry, I'm gonna come to that num workers, okay? For that only I am creating this example. So this is my new function takes time, okay? Now there might be a situation where we want to call this function takes time multiple times with different set of parameters. Happens with many of the thread functions, right? Calling the same thread function with different set of parameters. Here is how we can do that. We can use the map. So what I'm saying there, thread pool executor max worker as 1, result is equal to map. I'm calling a map in thread pool executor, and I'm giving thread function, and the parameter will be different. First it will take 2, then it will take 3. So if I go ahead and run this code, you can see that first the sleep function will be called with 2 seconds, then it will be called with 3 seconds, and overall wall time will be 5 seconds, clear? But if I change the num workers as 2, you can see the overall time is actually just 3 seconds, which means multi-threading is working, right? We have 2 threads, both are, you know, started simultaneously. One take 2 seconds, one take 3 seconds, overall wall time is 3 seconds. Now if I change the num worker threads to 10, what will be the output? What will be the output of wall time? Any guesses? It will remain 3 seconds because there are 2 threads and one will anyway sleep for 3 seconds. So overall time will anyway be 3 seconds. It will never be faster than that. And that's the precise reason you should be very careful about number of threads. You should know what is happening, what is going on. And that's the precise reason people do not get linear performance with number of threads. So this is the reason, okay? Now let's talk about return function. What if I want to return something from my thread function, okay? So here is my thread function. Let me create some space between these. So here what I'm trying to do is that I'm again changing the function and adding a return statement done with @ how many seconds this function had slept, okay? Now with thread pool executor, what we will do is that, let me again create a space over here. What is happening? Yes, I'm saying that, you know, map function, everything is same over here, but what will happen with the results? I can say for value in results, the return of map, and I can print those values. And you can see that workers are 2, so maximum wall time will be 3, and you can see that returns are 2 and 3. If the worker is 1, you can see that return will be 1 by 1, so overall wall time will be 5 seconds, okay? Now we can also use executor submit. There is another thing called executor submit. So in here, what we will do, instead of using map where we get the result as a parameter and we can use that parameter, we can use something called executor and submit. In the submit function, we will pass the function and the parameter, and for the parameter, we will use the same list. Okay, everything is same, just slight tweaking of the syntax, okay? So this is how we get the futures, okay? And in this particular case, we can see concurrent futures as completed. As in, when those futures are completed, we are gonna go ahead and we are gonna look into concurrent futures as and when completed, and as and when they are completed, I'm gonna see those futures one by one, results one by one. So here is how it looks like. One, max worker is 1, so it took 5 seconds. So what happened? I got a futures over here, okay? And then we are gonna see the results over here. So these are the three ways to use concurrent future with thread pool executor. If I change thread to process, the syntax will remain the same, but anyway, I'm gonna talk about that in next video because it has something more than just syntax part, similar syntax part, okay? So this is all I wanted to talk to you about Python programming concurrent.futures. I hope and believe that I was able to explain the same in the easiest possible way and you understand how it can be used. But whether you want to use it or not, it's your decision, it's individual programmer's decision. Thank you all, thanks for watching. We will definitely meet again. Until the next time we meet, good day, goodbye, you take care.